Hi, and welcome to Health Chats with Abington Health. I'm Cass Bailey from Philadelphia Magazine, and I'll be your host for tonight's web chat. Tonight, we're chatting with Dr. Andrew Starr, who specializes in total joint replacement. Dr. Starr is the medical director at Abington Health's Orthopedic and Spine Institute, located at both Abington Memorial Hospital and Lansdale Hospital. Okay, Dr. Starr, before we get started, can you tell us a little bit about your expertise?
Yes, I'm a joint replacement surgeon, so I practice at Abington Memorial Hospital and I do hip and knee replacements.
Well, thank you so much for joining us tonight and for sharing your expertise with us. Okay, so I want to start by talking about some more general questions about joints. Dr. Starr, can you tell us a little bit about the anatomy of our hip and knee joints, and why is pain in these joints so common?
Sure, I'd be glad to. I have some models here, which I'll bring in here. Hopefully we can see these. These are actually models of hips and knees that are already replaced. This is a hip model, but it helps you to see what a hip looks like. You have the femur bone here, and this is the socket up here. Now, in an artificial hip, we've replaced it, and you can see that this can move as a ball and socket joint. In a natural joint, you have bone and cartilage instead of these metal pieces and plastic pieces. I'm going to grab here also a knee joint. You can see a knee joint's a lot more complicated. It has the kneecap. I'll turn it to the side so you can see it. This is a side view. So you have the femur bone above, the tibia bone below, and the knee moves like this. When the kneecap is on the front, you can see this is the quadriceps muscle up here, and this is a replaced knee, so it has metal and plastic, but in a non-replaced knee, it would just be cartilage on the surface of the bone.
So what are some conservative options for people who are experiencing hip or knee pain?
Well, you know, conservative, generally we mean non-operative. So that could be very simple treatments like anti-inflammatories, over-the-counter ibuprofen or naproxen. That could be injections, which are performed in doctor's offices, and many different kinds of doctors do that. We prescribe physical therapy, braces, and what's really the least popular choice, which is using a cane or a walker. Even our older patients, they really don't like it when we tell them they could use a cane or a walker to unweight their joint.
So What then is the criteria to replace a knee or a hip, and when do you know that it's time to start looking at that option?
Well, I tell people that it really is their option. The doctor who sees you looks at the studies like the x-rays and the CAT scans and MRI scans, and we see whether there's cartilage remaining and whether there's damage. Usually when the arthritis gets into the bone, you start talking about having the knee or the hip replaced. But you have to have tried conservative management first. In fact, a lot of the insurance companies now are requiring that you go to therapy first, that you go to have injections or take medications. But the most important thing is the doctor really doesn't tell you to have a replacement. The doctor tells you that we can help you with a replacement. The fundamental issue is quality of life. So if you feel like you're not living your life, and we're going to talk, I'm sure, with some other questions later about ages of patients, but my youngest patient I've replaced their knee or hip was 21, and my oldest was 98. So everybody makes their decisions about whether they should have their knee or hip replaced in the context of what it is that they can or cannot do.
Is it as effective as traditional surgery?
Well, there's some controversy about it and what it means. Minimally invasive surgery is really about a philosophy. And it's not just the cuts that we make, but it's how we treat the patient from the standpoint of pain control, how quickly we rehabilitate them. So minimally invasive surgery, which started out in orthopedics maybe 10, 15 years ago, was about not cutting the muscle, making a smaller cut, and we thought that was going to make the difference. Now, though, we understand that we need to control the pain better, and there's new technology for that, that we need to mobilize the patient a lot more quickly in terms of their physical therapy and their rehabilitation. And I would say to you that I think that the results are better with minimally invasive surgery, or certainly equal to what we did before, but the patients seem to accept it much better.
Okay, so a little bit of a pre-surgery question now that we've gotten the basics out of the way. How does osteoarthritis and osteoporosis affect hip and knee surgery?
Well, this is a great question because patients are very confused by this and the general public is confused. So if you're contemplating you're having a surgery or your mother or father, people really get confused. Osteoarthritis refers to the wear and tear arthritis, and that's the most common cause of arthritis and the need for knee and hip replacements in the world. So the person who played football and tore their cartilage or had a trick knee, you know, they wear it out, they damage it, the construction worker, someone who falls, that's the typical osteoarthritis. Osteoporosis or osteopenia, which refer to the same thing basically, are talking about the quality of the bone. So we know that people as they get older, particularly women more than men, but everybody, their bones get weaker and thinner. Now, when we do replacements, we have to account for the weakness and thinness of the bone, and we can do that very effectively. So it really doesn't relate so much. The osteoarthritis is the reason we're doing the replacement. The osteoporosis or the osteopenia is just a factor like any other, like someone who has diabetes or someone who has high blood pressure, that we have to take into consideration when we perform a surgical procedure.
Is there a certain age that is too young for a hip replacement? How is the age of a candidate balanced against their current level of impairment and pain?
Well, that's really the key factor. When you look at a patient who's having pain, it's an easier decision if they're the perfect patient. I would tell you the perfect patient is probably somebody 70 to 75 years old. And the reason for that is they're old enough that you probably won't have to do the replacement again, but they're young enough to go through the surgery successfully. Now, we could spend 2 hours talking about all the criteria that we use, basically looking at their overall health, have they had a stent and is their heart causing them a problem, do they have diabetes, do they have other kinds of heart disease. Fundamentally, though, as we look at a patient, we have to look at their individual situation. And if they have severe pain and they can't do what they want to do, that's a very strong reason to have a joint replacement. But we also have to recognize the joints don't last forever. And that's the reason there's a concern about younger patients having replacements. Generally speaking, you can do it about 3 times.
Okay. So given that, and given the fact that you can replace it about 3 times, we had a viewer question come in, and that person, the viewer asked, is 44 too young for a knee replacement?
Well, that fits right with what we're talking about. Okay. You know, your tendency to want to do a replacement is greater the older you get, up to about 70 or 75, and then your tendency declines some. So, you know, you get a person 80, 90 years old, we certainly do a lot of replacements at that age, but they have to be a very healthy, active person. By the same token, a 44-year-old, you start to think twice, because if the knee or hip's going to last maybe about 15, maybe 20 years if you're lucky, you're going to be back to do it again, and it just becomes a numbers game. Are you going to be able to get through this person's life with 2 or 3 hip or knee replacements, or are you going to get to the point where you just don't have enough bone left to do the operation over again?
Yeah, and that's kind of a scary thing. We had another viewer question come in that's kind of similar. This viewer asks, I am a 5'8" female and I weigh 270 pounds. Am I too obese for a knee replacement surgery? And would I be a candidate for minimally invasive surgery?
Well, those are all components of the questions that we discuss when somebody comes into the office, and every orthopedic surgeon would discuss that. And everybody has sort of their limits of how heavy is heavy. We know that if you get up to a body mass index over 40, which is in many people's cases about 100 pounds overweight, that the complication rate goes up. So the question I ask, I was in the office this afternoon, I have several patients I was talking to, and they were body mass index 41, 42. So you can offer them the option of saying, well, hey, how about losing 25 or 30 pounds, get yourself into a little better category, and doing the surgery. So you're balancing those complications. Obviously, it's ultimately a patient's decision whether they want to take this on. But I think that weight is a significant issue to orthopedic surgery, both in terms of getting through the surgery safely, as well as how these joints are going to hold up over a period of time. So I think it's worth discussing, and it has to be done in the context of how disabled they are. But I've done some quite heavy patients' joint replacements. Now, it impacts the minimally invasive approach. Mm-hmm. It doesn't impact the philosophy, meaning you can do the fancy pain control and the rapid rehab, mm-hmm. the other things that we do for our patients where we don't really want to turn them into invalids. We want to get them up and moving so mm-hmm. all their health systems continue to work well. But it does impact the ability to make that smaller incision and to do the surgery safely.
Is there a relationship between, a causal relationship between obesity and knee or hip replacements or knee and hip pain?
Well, you know, that's the ultimate chicken and egg problem. People who are heavy wear their joints out more quickly, and that's definitely, there's been studies that show that arthritis progresses more quickly in heavy people. By the same token, people constantly complain they can't exercise and they get heavy because they are, their joints aren't working.
They have pain, sure.
Right. So, I mean, this is definitely that chicken and egg situation. And, you know, I think it's a major component for the United States because we're a heavy country as a whole, and it may be part of the reason we do so many joint replacements, particularly in younger patients now.
Interesting. Let me ask some questions, if I can, specifically about surgery. What is the difference between anterior and posterior hip surgery, and how do those surgeries differ?
Well, this is definitely one of the most exciting things that I've seen in orthopedic surgery in the last 10 years. And basically, anterior means front, posterior means back. We need to access the hip joint. So when you're talking about a hip surgery, in this case we're talking hips, you're talking about putting in replacement. And I showed before, I'll show it again, this is what a joint replacement looks like.
Mm-hmm.
So we've got to get this piece, and I'm going to take this apart so you can really see it. This mm-hmm. is the ball. So this stem needs to go into this piece here.
Okay.
The socket, which is plastic and metal in this case, needs to fit in as well. Now, can we do this surgery through a couple-inch incision? The answer is yes.
Wow.
But the question is, how do we get to the joint? So in past years, a very successful approach was to put an incision in the buttocks region or on the side of the hip, cut the muscles, and do the replacement. And the typical recovery in a patient like that was filled with a lot of restrictions. So don't bend over, don't cross your legs, don't lay on your side. There's a lot of don'ts. I'm not much of a don't person. On an anterior hip surgery, we don't cut the muscles. And most importantly, we don't cut those ligaments in the back of the hip that are responsible for the hip stability. Now, accessing the joint through the front of the hip has been a complicated thing, and we use a lot of technology for that. So we now do our surgeries with x-ray control, so we're actually watching as we're putting the pieces in, and we can measure very precisely. Many of us use a special table that allows us to move the patient into a position that allows us to access that joint, because putting that big stem in from the front, the stomach kind of gets in the way.
Mm.
So that's an important part of this. So basically, the technology has gotten to the point where we can now do these surgeries without cutting the muscles, and our patients are up and moving quickly. And I know we're going to discuss a little bit about the postoperative recovery, so I'll stop yeah. there and we can cover that in a minute.
So are you actively doing these surgeries that you described right now at Abington?
We do about 1,500 joint replacements a year at Abington. We do a high percentage of our cases are minimally invasive, whether it's a hip or a knee.
And are you doing both the anterior and the posterior hip surgery that we just discussed?
Well, personally, I do 99% of my cases anterior because I think it's a better, less invasive type of approach. If you have a very complex patient, you know, maybe they had multiple prior surgeries, maybe they're severely obese, I'm talking 450 pounds, we can't do the anterior. It's just very difficult to access the patient in that way. So there are some reasons why you might say to a patient, hey, this isn't the right way to go. But the vast majority of my surgeries are anterior, and we have a little bit of a mix. We have some guys who still do some posterior surgeries. They're very safe. They're very effective. Mm-hmm. I just think the recovery is a little bit longer.
You showed us the replacement for the hip. Can you also just walk us through what a knee replacement looks like and what that is like?
You know, there's nothing better than a surgeon than to be asked about surgery. We kind of like that. So we'd be happy to take a look at that. This is a knee replacement model. So we have the white bone above and the white bone below. The first thing I will say is every patient I talk to about a knee replacement who hasn't seen a picture of it t- tells me that they thought I was going to cut the bone up here and cut the bone down here and put this huge thing in there. But a knee replacement, at least the first time you do it, is just a resurfacing. So what we have to do is the bone is irregular, the surface of the bone is irregular, top and bottom, and you've lost the cartilage in between. So simply, a knee replacement is cap the bone with metal to make it smooth on the top, that's the femur, cap the tibia with metal so that it's smooth, and put a piece of plastic in between that makes up for that meniscus cartilage that's in between that you've lost. Now there's also, you can see it here, there's a little plastic cap on the back of the kneecap. Mm-hmm. And that also resurfaces the kneecap.
Okay.
So four pieces, that's a knee replacement. And I'll show you it moving. You know, it bends and moves just like a regular knee.
Wow. Is there any difference in the implants that you use, whether or not the procedure is traditional or minimally invasive?
No, fortunately, we don't really have to change the implants very much. There's some instrumentation differences, so some of the pieces that we use, the instruments, the blades, things like that we use to make these cuts, have to be able to fit into a smaller incision. But knee replacements have not changed since minimally invasive surgery came on the scene, and basically hips have not either. We really haven't changed the implants, and that allows us to give patients greater confidence that even though these are relatively new procedures, the outcomes are going to be similar. And that's basically been the experience thus far. As long as you get the joints in correctly, as long as you can do a good job, as long as you can monitor them, position, alignment, get them to fit properly, they should function just like a typical knee and hip replacement. And we've got 45 years of experience putting these devices in and knowing that they're successful.
So let me talk a little bit about post-surgery now. How many hours after minimally invasive surgery can someone get up and start walking around? And is there a difference between hips and knees in that regard?
Well, clearly with the minimally invasive technology, the hips are doing better. This anterior hip surgery, we started to do minimally invasive hip replacements in this area around 2001. At Abington, we really got an early start on it. We converted to it very quickly because we liked it. And that was smaller incisions, but that was the posterior. That was the old-fashioned through the buttocks. We made a smaller incision. We didn't quite cut so much muscle, but we started with that. And, you know, that was a nice improvement. The patients liked it. But we really, it wasn't the whole philosophy. It wasn't the rapid rehab protocols, the fast discharge, the patients asking us to go home because they were doing so well, the pain control. I mean, that you have to have it all. It's not just the cut. We started in 2006 to do the anterior hip surgery, and we've gotten to the point where, as I mentioned, I do about 99% of my regular hips through that approach. And our patients get up basically a couple hours after the surgery, and they stand and walk.
Wow.
They go to the bathroom. Oh, yeah, it's great. And it's the first time in my career that patients have asked me to go home. I have patients the night of surgery who say, I'm doing fine. Can I leave now? I'm kind of a stick in the mud. I make them stay the night. But a lot of the patients go home the next day or certainly by 2 days for a hip. That's very, very common. Now, the knee's a little different. And so a knee replacement, for some reason, they have a little tougher time. It's a lot more physical therapy. They have a greater difficulty getting their range of motion. And so those patients, we still have the rapid rehab protocol. We get them up the night of surgery, they move, but we have to use more blocks, which means nerve blocks, to, you know, make the leg feel more comfortable after the surgery. It just seems like they're more sore. So they have benefited also from the non-muscle cutting, minimally invasive surgery philosophy. And I keep saying it's a philosophy because it is. Because it has to have all those things. We make the patients do therapy many times before surgery, so they're really ready to do therapy afterwards. And we get them going pretty quickly, but they work a little bit harder. But they still get up right away. Everybody walks the morning after.
That's amazing. How does that recovery time compare to traditional joint replacement surgeries?
I always like to say that when I started my residency, we used to keep the patients in 3 days before the surgery, and they stayed in the hospital for 3 weeks.
Wow.
Nowadays, yeah, it's amazing. It's hard to imagine. Well, we used to also have patients who used to come in the hospital for a rest. So the times were quite different. Nowadays, you know, hospitals are places for people who need them. And so the patients come in the day of surgery, and they usually leave the hospital anywhere from 1 to 3 days. I would say in this area, we're getting to the point where less than half of our patients feel the need to go somewhere other than their home. So the vast majority of the hips surgeries go home directly to their own house, and we send a therapist to their home for a couple of weeks. The vast majority of the knee surgeries, probably about half of the knee surgeries now, go directly home, and that number is increasing. We still have some of our older patients and more debilitated patients who go to extended care facilities for several days after that. But that's markedly different from an environment where they stayed in the hospital 3.5 weeks.
Let's talk about total recovery time. How long does it take to back to normal with their new knee or hip following a minimally invasive surgery?
Well, there's different waypoints. You know, when you ask people, how long is it going to take me to recover, some people want to know how soon can they drive. Mm. And a lot of our patients can drive in a week or two after a hip replacement. After a knee, if it's the knee we operated on, I have them wait a month. But if it's not the knee we operate on, if it's a left knee, then we let them drive pretty much right away, as soon as they're off painkillers. As far as when you're fully recovered, I don't think you fully recover from surgery and get all your strength back. It's kind of like training for a marathon for a year. But in terms of getting back to work, a lot of our hip replacement patients are back in 2-3 weeks, which is very much different. And a lot of our knee replacement patients are coming along pretty well by a month or 6 weeks.
You mentioned painkillers. Let's talk about pain. What is the difference in the pain that people experience following a minimally invasive procedure versus a more traditional joint replacement?
I have to kind of give a disclaimer because obviously I've been involved in minimally invasive types of surgery since 2001. I'm kind of like the biggest advocate around here for this. Now, a lot of other surgeons are on the bandwagon now, but I think it really is something that, you know, we've been excited about at Abington for more than a decade. Pain control is a very individualized thing. I would tell you my personal experience, and you know, yeah, we argue about these things at national meetings and professional meetings all the time. My personal experience with hip replacements is that the hip replacement patient through an anterior approach has substantially less pain than anything we've seen before, and the majority of those patients never have to take an injectable pain medication. The knee replacements, my sense is that they're better. When I talk to our physical therapists, they tell me they're getting moving quicker, they're getting off their pain medicine more quickly, but it's still a longer process. My personal opinion, and I'm going to say this with 20 disclaimers because, you know, people across the country debate this and some people at very fancy medical centers talk about it and say they don't fully believe it, but I think if you do all of the components of minimally invasive rapid rehab surgery, the patients get better faster and they get off their medications faster and they get back to their lives more quickly, which is what they want.
Yeah, for sure. Let's talk a little bit about the joints and the replacement joints themselves. How long does a hip replacement or a knee replacement typically last?
Well, we can't talk about longevity on hip and knee replacements without talking about all the things that you see on television. Everything from claims of manufacturers that their joints can last 30 years, down to claims that you see on late night television about joints that are hurting people and problems that they're having with them. The history of joint replacement in this country started in the 60s. It started with a joint, and I showed you some of the joints already, but I'll keep going back to it. It started with a joint very much like this. It had a plastic socket and a metal ball. This is a ceramic ball, but they have metal as well. Those joints have held up for decades, for 10, 15, sometimes 20 years, some of them longer than that. But, you know, patients, you can tell them with a good degree of confidence that the joints we've been using for years, and this really has stood the test of time, can give you 15 years in most cases, often 20. The longest I ever saw a joint last was 40 years.
Wow.
Which was unusual, you know, and the history is that we're putting them in more active people now, so they're, of course, beating them up. Now, the limiting factor in all of these joints is the plastic surface, because you're going to wear the plastic out. It's like making tires for your car out of rubber. You're going to wear the tread off that rubber eventually, and you're going to ultimately have to put a new tire on. And the nice thing about the joints now is they're modular, so you can pull the plastic piece out and save the rest and put a new one in.
So you might not have to get a total hip replacement the second time. You could just get a part of it replaced.
Yeah, we do that quite often. You know, with the modular hips, we're not seeing a lot of the older hips now, the one-piece and two-piece hips that we used to see. So those you had to pull the whole thing out. But with the modular hips, which we've been using for about 20 years or more, you can pull that plastic piece out, and that's one of the more common revisions that we do, and that can be done minimally invasive as well. You know, some of your bigger revisions where you have to pull the stem out, cut the bone, and do a lot of work, well, you really need to get in there and really see what's going on very clearly. But the head and liner exchanges, we call them, you can bring a patient in, do a head and liner exchange, it takes an hour, not touch the bone, and you can have them totally minimally invasively and same rehab protocol and home in a day or two.
How about knee replacements? How long do they typically last?
It's not a great deal different for knee replacements. Knee replacements, same thing, metal and plastic articulation. The plastic's going to wear out. The limiting factor seems to be how quickly that plastic wears and how the body reacts to it. The body has no way to get rid of that plastic debris, and eventually it builds up and it starts to deteriorate. So we're seeing 15, 20 years out of knees. They're very reliable. And, you know, you look at the statistics and the kinds of numbers we're seeing up at 15 years approaches 90%. So it's high numbers. Now, there is a drop-off as you get further than that and you get out to 16, 17, 20 years, depending upon how active the person is. And, of course, it depends a lot. You know, we talked about that 44-year-old, and her replacement is going to be, you know, 15 years old. When she's 60 years old, she's still going to have high demand. You know, what I see sometimes is I put a joint replacement in someone who's 80, and you start to see a little wear around, you know, 90, 95 years old, but they're not exactly playing soccer at that age. So they may tolerate, you know, that just because it's wearing a little bit, you don't have to take it out necessarily.
Is there a limit to how many times somebody could have a revision or a new joint replaced?
Well, you certainly start to approach a limit as you start to do a lot of more invasive surgeries. So, you know, if a person comes to me with three or four prior surgeries, you know, arthroscopic, maybe they had a fracture, and now we're doing a replacement, we've already burned a few bridges before we get into the replacement. Generally, three or four surgeries on a knee, you start to have a little more problems. The tissues aren't as good. There's a lot of scar tissue. You start to lose range of motion. Generally, your first knee replacement's pretty good, or first hip replacement. The second one, you probably can salvage pretty well, but then you start losing bone. And it's a little bit like when the hinges are coming loose on your door, you start shoving toothpicks in there. You know, we lose the bone to adhere to, and we don't have the ability to put a new door jamb on. You know, we just have to keep shoving toothpicks in there. So we have a lot of great technology for revisions, but you do reach a limit, and that's why the conversation I have, particularly with the heavy younger patient, is how many replacements are we going to be able to do, and, you know, are we going to get to the point where you're just not going to be satisfied with the result?
So I'd like to remind everyone watching that you can submit your questions for Dr. Starr at any time right below this video. They'll be kept confidential. We don't need your name or contact information, and we'll do our best to get to as many of the questions as we can. So, Dr. Starr, I have a question right now that was submitted by an audience member. I was diagnosed with osteoarthritis in both knees. I've had three shots of Euflexa in both knees with no results. Is there something else I should look into before considering joint replacement?
Well, Euflexa is a brand name for a gel that comes from, in the case of Euflexa, it's actually made in a laboratory, but most of these gels come from chicken cartilage. And there's about six or seven manufacturers. They go by a bunch of different names. And we generally do shots in patients' knees, and we put this gel in. And what it's supposed to do is make the knee feel better for about 6 months. It's one of many options that person has, including cortisone injections, which is an anti-inflammatory and pain-killing medications like ibuprofen, or some fancier things like Celebrex or meloxicam, which people use, which are prescription. Physical therapy can be effective. Braces on the knee can be effective. And as I mentioned at the beginning of the program, a lot of people don't want to use canes, but they work. Now, if you get to the point where your x-rays and your CAT scans and MRI scans show that there's no cartilage left, what do you do? You know, you're hurting. You can't play golf if you're retired. You can't go to work if you're a carpenter. Or even I have secretaries who say, I can't get up from my desk and walk because I'm so stiff. What do you do at that point? Well, at a certain point, you look at your health, you look at your age, and most importantly, your quality of life, and you replace the knee or the hip. For this person, though, that's the conversation you want to have. And you know, I always break it down with the patients. There's three options. You can do nothing. You can treat the symptoms, which is many of the things that I mentioned, but it doesn't change the disease. Putting a gel in your knee doesn't change the arthritis. It just makes you able to tolerate it. Or you can do a replacement. And I think you need to consider all those ramifications. And that's the most important conversation that you have with a prospective surgeon, is what is their approach? How do they do this? And then you can get into the technicalities of, well, how many replacements do you do a year? You know, some people like me do 7-8 replacements a day. Some people do a couple a month. You know, do they specialize? Do they have interest in the minimally invasive philosophy and programs, which people talk about a lot, but really, I think, do add to what we can offer these patients?
That's great. We actually got a question just now that was to that effect. What question should I ask a doctor when deciding to have my surgery? But it sounds like you answered that question already, so thank you for that. We also had a follow-up question. Somebody asked, does glucosamine chondroitin work for joint pain?
Well, glucosamine chondroitin is a supplement. Actually, glucosamine and chondroitin make up some of the constituents of, they are some of the constituents of cartilage. So supposedly, if you put this material in your body, you eat it, basically, it's going to make you develop more cartilage. It's very controversial. A lot of people take it because it's cheap and available. It's like a lot of supplements. As far as I'm concerned, there's absolutely no side effects of glucosamine and chondroitin. But it's a supplement, very difficult to measure the effect. Excuse me. I'm not against people trying these types of things, but we don't know if they work. The American Academy of Orthopedic Surgery recommendation is that these are not really helpful. However, I have a lot of patients who use them, and I'm not against their use.
Are there any vitamins or supplements that you do recommend to your patients?
Now, you know, there really isn't anything. I mean, the common things out there, glucosamine chondroitin is the most common. MSM is another one. And then there's all mixtures of things which are under proprietary names, which are advertised. Now, we talked about that osteoarthritis, which is the primary disease that I treat, is different than osteoporosis. We certainly recommend vitamin D and calcium for patients who have osteoporosis. We think that is part of a healthy lifestyle. As far as the specific supplements for osteoarthritis, I would try them. I think they're worth it if you want to try them, but there's not a lot of basis that says, yes, these are things that are essential or that effective.
We have another viewer question. This person asks, I am 39 and I've had 4 knee surgeries, 3 arthroscopic and a full arthrotomy over the past 27 years. I am active, but I still have severe pain constantly, day and night. My knee still has subluxation, and I was told I would need a replacement when I was 30-ish. Due to knee replacements not lasting more than 10 years, in this viewer's question, would any doctor consider replacing mine now? I do exercises for it, and I ice and I heat, but I still have pain. Steps are almost impossible for me.
How old was the patient? I missed the beginning.
That's okay. The patient is 39.
Okay. You know, because that puts us in context in terms of how you evaluate this. Certainly, there are doctors who will do a replacement in a person 39 years old. I've done it many times. You try to optimize those patients. If you're going to operate on a patient who's that young, and we figure that a knee or a hip can last 15, 20 years, and you start doing that, well, can I do this, and is it going to last for 15 years each time, and will I get, you know, 45 plus 39, is that approximately the lifespan of a person? That's the kind of discussion you have. It's kind of a hard discussion. And you ask the patient, well, you know, is there heart disease in your family? How long do people live? If everybody in your family lives to 102, you may look at it differently. But definitely 39 years old is not an absolute contraindication, meaning we can't do it, but you got to have everything right. And, you know, the patient, in my opinion, wants to be someone who's thin and active and is willing to keep their muscles strong, and they're not in a heavy kind of a job. They're not a carpenter. They're not a construction worker. Because, you know, I've had patients wear their knees out with their occupations, artificial knee, occupationally related wear out in 6 years. So that, and then, you know, now you're talking about a very young patient if it only lasts for 6 years, you're going to get to the point where you can't put another knee in that person.
I have another question. This person asks, I have a severely disabled daughter, and although I have osteoarthritis, bone spurs, and have had 3 surgeries to repair torn meniscus in the knee, I still somewhat run and do intense workouts. With that said, what is the average recovery time that I should adhere to before running or working out?
That's a great question, because there's a million questions built into that. Well, first of all, most joint replacement surgeons would tell you that running is probably not the best exercise after a replacement. I've had numerous patients come to me over the years, you know, they're 60, 65 years old or maybe younger, and they say, well, you know what, my times are going up in the Broad Street run. I'd really like to get my knee replaced so I can run faster, or my hip replaced. The problem is, you know, this plastic wafer that's in between the knee joint is going to take all the force of that running. When you put your leg down walking, there's not a big jolt because you're going from one foot to the other smoothly. When you run, you're basically jumping up in the air and then coming down on that plastic right there. So you've got maybe 7-8 millimeters of plastic that's got to take all that abuse. My opinion, and this is an opinion shared by most orthopedic surgeons who do a large volume of knee replacements, is that running is not a good exercise. So let's get back, not a good exercise for someone with an artificial joint. Let's get back to the meat of the question, which is, well, okay, how soon can I go back to my activities after a joint replacement? Well, it's different for a hip and for a knee to some degree. Hips, the bone has to adhere to the metal. We don't use glue in a hip. So you figure that's a 6-8 week process. So if you're going to go back to the more strenuous activities, maybe playing golf or a little doubles tennis or something like that, I'd probably wait a minimum of 6 or 8 weeks. In knees, it's probably not a whole lot different, but those are glued joints, so they're pretty much glued. The metal pieces are glued to the bone in most cases, so you don't really have to wait for that to heal in. But most knee replacement patients, I would say, can get back to very low impact type of things like the bike and the elliptical within a few weeks, and then more strenuous things in 3 months. So you're in that kind of time frame, but we get patients back into their activities, their exercises, the elliptical, the bike, things like that, really pretty quickly, a few weeks.
That's great. Another viewer writes in and asks, I hear some hospitals advertise that they do knee replacement surgery that does not split the muscle around the knee. Does Abington use that procedure?
Well, as I mentioned, you know, we got involved in that in 2001, or at least I started that in 2001, and a bunch of the other doctors started to do it as well. And basically, we do adhere to the principles associated with trying to be as minimally invasive as possible. But some of the things we learned at the beginning was, as I mentioned before, it's not the cut. It's not even necessarily the cutting the muscle. It's everything. So you can do a more invasive style of surgery, but yet utilize this minimally invasive philosophy of rapid rehabilitation, of express pain control. We actually give our patients pain medicines before they are put under anesthesia. We use a lot of spinal anesthetics, so we don't have a lot of the complications associated with putting people to sleep. And I would say to you that this is all part of being a minimally invasive or a rapid recovery sort of program. The thing people tend to jump on is this muscle cutting thing. And I think it's valid. It certainly is valid, in my opinion, in the hip. In the knee, you know, it's one of many factors that we utilize. But we definitely believe it at Abington. We have probably 2/3 of our surgeons who practice that way almost exclusively. And I do think there's value to it, although I would have to be honest, because I've already mentioned that I'm kind of, you know, the leader in this. I love it, and I think it's the way to go. So not everybody's going to agree 100%, but I think no one can argue that our patients now in 2014 aren't getting better faster and getting back to their lives more quickly.
Right, and that's really what matters. Somebody wrote and asked, what's the best way, and I love this question, what's the best way to avoid knee and hip surgery altogether, and how can I keep my joints healthy?
That's the ultimate. We talked about earlier in the program, one of the big risk factors for arthritis in the knee, for osteoarthritis, wear and tear arthritis, is obesity. You know, if we could cure obesity in this country, we would probably, I can't give you a statistic, but you know, we do almost 1 million knee and hip replacements in this country a year. probably going over 1 million now. And if we got rid of the obesity epidemic, there'd be a lot of orthopedic surgeons like myself who would be a lot less busy. So I would say to you, you know, first and foremost, you can't change your genetics. If your mother had a knee replacement, if your father had a knee replacement, if your brother's 52 and he's had a knee replacement, you know, this is something you may have to deal with. However, if you keep yourself thin, if you do reasonable activity, too much, ultra marathons, not just a marathon, but, you know, these people who run these crazy distances are things that are probably too much. A lot of pounding sort of activities is probably too much. Occupational overuse, you know, roofers and tile mace, stone masons and people who do terribly heavy work. And so it comes down to being healthy. Exercise moderately, keep yourself thin, and your joints are going to treat you very well.
Are joint problems hereditary?
There's definitely a hereditary component, and it's like a lot of things. You know, the person whose mother and father had heart disease is more likely to have heart disease. But if they don't smoke and they control their diabetes and they exercise, you know, they can overcome some of that. So just because mom or dad had arthritis doesn't mean you're going to get it, and just because mom or dad didn't have arthritis, unfortunately, doesn't mean you're spared from arthritis. But it is a factor, and it's a factor that goes in with other things like how your alignment is. You know, a person who's terribly bow-legged and lives their whole life that way, the forces on the inside of the knee joint are go up significantly. So they're much more likely to have arthritis when they get older. So it's one of many factors.
A viewer wrote in and asked, I had a total knee replacement back in April 2013, and I am still in pain 8 months later. Is the Stryker knee replacement different from a regular knee replacement? And if yes, how so? Would you recommend that this patient gets a second opinion?
Well, there's about three different questions built into that. So the first thing is, there's no real evidence that one knee replacement is that much better than another. I love the knee replacement companies. They do a great job. They develop great implants. You know, 45 years later, we're into a mature technology where they all sort of copy the best things from each other. Are there studies that show, you know, in large numbers of patients that brand X, brand Y, or brand Z is any better? I would say no. That's my opinion. I probably have a lot of implant salesmen yelling at me now. But I don't think that there's a major difference between the implants. Now, they're showing you sort of the tough side of joint replacements. And let's just do the math. If you do 600,000 knee replacements in the United States a year, which is probably close to a number that we can agree has been done for the last few years, and if it's 90% successful, then 10% of those knee replacements, or a whole lot of patients, are going to not have a successful result. Now, fortunately, the vast majority of those patients have an okay result. So a patient who you might consider a failure is a patient who says, I don't love the way my knee feels. But about 10% of our patients, and this has been consistent for many years, don't have a fantastic result. They may not have a serious complication, but they're still fussing with it. Now, it's always worth getting another opinion if what's going on doesn't seem to be making sense to you. Now, sometimes the doctor will just look at you and say, look, it looks perfect. I think we've done everything we can. There's no negative signs. We've done appropriate tests and studies. You've done great in therapy, and it's just the best we can do.
We have another case. This person says, I am a 54-year-old with arthritis in both knees, and I have received Synvisc injections in both knees several times. I'm obese, and I would like to know if I would be considered for minimally invasive surgery.
You can imagine, you know, with all this lingo and all these terms, you know, Synvisc, Eflex, all this kind of stuff. I can see you're having some fun with that, Cass, because I'm sure these are new words to you.
Blast.
Exactly, but you know. The questions are two really sort of different things. I mean, he's doing the conservative things like the Synvisc or cortisone or therapy or things like that. So he's clearly evaluating that. Once again, he's a middle-aged kind of person, 54 years old, but there's an obesity issue. So, you know, the question is what's best for that person? Is there an option of modest weight reduction and a replacement? I will say a bigger patient, for one of two reasons, and there's one you can control and one you can't, you have to make a bigger incision. It doesn't mean you still don't do the minimally invasive, you don't stay out of the muscle where possible, you can still do the rapid rehab, the pain control, all the things that make this a minimally invasive experience or a rapid recovery experience. But one thing that would help is reducing the weight, because if it's a bigger patient, we have to make a bigger cut. Now, the other part you can control, which is our implants come in a range of sizes. One of the things that's changed a lot in recent years, when we first started to do replacements, we had a couple of sizes. Well, the companies and the doctors have figured out that if we have knees that fit better, you know, whether this is the concept of a woman's knee or a concept of just a better fitting knee, which I think what we've come to now, if we can fit the knee better, we're going to be in a better situation. So I think you want to try to optimize things for that patient. If you're going to put a bigger knee in, you know, you're going to have to make a bigger cut. So if a person's big boned or heavy, it's going to be somewhat less invasive. But I would tell you that I think those differences are minute. And you're really going to, if you go through the program and you go to somebody who really subscribes to this sort of technology, and thankfully a lot of doctors are doing this now, we at Abington have believed in it for a long time, and I think it's going to be a better way. But once again, controversial, and I always give my disclaimer because that's what I like and that's what I do.
So we have somebody write in who says, I am 65 years old and had my right hip replaced in 2009 and my left knee replaced in 2012. The knee replacement is not doing well. I'm in constant pain that never goes away. My doctor said the pain is caused by the left hip and suggest I have my left hip replaced. Now remember, this patient had their right hip replaced in 2009. I am afraid to have the surgery because I want to be certain that the pain is coming from the left hip and not my left knee, which I had replaced. I want to be pain-free and have my quality of life back. What would you recommend for this patient?
Well, it's an awesome question because it's the type of thing we talk about all the time. You know, we have specialists within our hospital and our program that specialize in backs, hip and knee replacements, sports medicine. And, you know, one of the problems is that we become so specialized, we tend to focus on one or another thing. So a patient will come in, they don't know where to go, they have pain in their buttocks, and they go see a spine doctor, and the spine doctor says, hey, wait a minute, yeah, I think your spine's pretty good, it's probably coming from your hip. There's a lot of overlap, there's a lot of great mimickers. Hip pain, hip arthritis can cause knee pain. Hmm. It's rare that knee arthritis causes hip pain, but it just has to do with how the nerves run. This is an area where other opinions sometimes do help, you know, in terms of getting people's feelings about it. Generally speaking, on an examination, I can tell a little bit because if I move the hip and the knee hurts, it's probably coming from the hip. If you inject the hip, which you can do with cortisone or Novocaine or something like that, local anesthetic, and it numbs the pain for, you know, several days or a week, you may get a better sense that it's coming from the hip, not the knee. A lot of times it's coming from both. And we have to tell a lot of patients, well, your hip's bad, we can take away some percentage of your pain with a hip replacement, but we don't know if all the knee pain's going to go away.
This question comes from probably the youngest viewer we've had write in today. She writes, I am a 25-year-old woman that runs 2 to 3 times per week. Occasionally, I experience pain in my knees on longer runs. Could I possibly need a knee replacement in 15 or 20 years?
Well, the answer to the question is anything's possible. You know, just because somebody has some soreness when they run a distance doesn't necessarily mean that there's a major structural problem. There can be a lot of reasons for that. And you tend to look at certain warning signs. You know, if the knee swells, you know, a young person like that who's running shouldn't have their knee swell. I mean, they could be a little sore after running. If it's consistent, they should probably see a sports medicine doctor and have somebody take a look at their knee and see if there's any warning signs that they may be overlooking. Pain is a pretty good measure that maybe you're overdoing it a little bit, and maybe, you know, the longer runs should be once a week instead of twice a week. You know, there's a lot of technology in running. It may be a structural problem. I mean, if I see a patient who has a perfectly built leg, meaning the alignment's great, they're not bow-legged, they're not knock-kneed, you know, they don't have a patella that's sliding into a bad position, they don't have a lot of clicking and popping, I may be more inclined to say to that person, well, you know what? You're probably not doing any damage. Keep going. If there's a lot of risk factors and a lot of concerns, then you may say no. So I would say anybody who has persistent pain, even if they're young, they need to worry that they're going to start to have other problems. and they should probably see somebody and at least go over those risk factors and see whether what they're doing is sensible in the long run.
This question is from a concerned wife. She says, my husband needs a knee replacement, but he can barely walk, but he keeps delaying it. I feel like it's really impacting his quality of life and mine too. What can I do to encourage him?
Well, you know, we have two chairs in every room in our office, and we tend to see the husbands and the wives. And, of course, the wives are the great controllers of healthcare in this country. They tend to do a lot of research, and they tend to really try to make sure that what's being done is right. There's a lot of messages here. Generally speaking, we tell patients that there's no great harm in waiting to do a hip or knee replacement. Now, there's an extreme to that, which is that, you know, if you lose your muscle tone, if the joint becomes fused, you know, at the tremendous extremes, you can wait too long. But basically, you can wait as long as you like. But, you know, there's another key message there, and that's the quality of life one, mm-hmm. which is that, you know, this person can wait another few years and have their knee or hip replaced, and they'll probably have a great result. But the question is, why are they waiting, and who's it impacting? And, you know, the funny message here is really the wife is saying, boy, he's starting to drive me crazy. Get your darn joint fixed already because, you know, I want to get on with things. I want to go visit the grandchildren. I want to go, you know, on the vacation. And every time I go, you sit in the room and you don't come with me. So there's a lot of messages here. You know, medicine is about taking care of the whole patient. You asked me questions about the technology of joint replacements. And, you know, for me, that's just fun. It's fun to, you know, look at all the fancy equipment and the new stuff we get. I mean, we just love toys. But the fact of the matter is, fundamentally, this comes down to the person. Our programs at Abington, we like to say that we're a patient-centered or patient-focused environment. And it's funny, it comes down to little things like this, which is, how does it impact the rest of the family? And, you know, you have to really sit there and look at the patient. And our nurses and our doctors look at not just the patient, but the family and sort of see what's going on. And when we advise people, you know, we may give them a little nudge because we see that maybe they're not being realistic about the impact that this is having around them.
Thank you for that. And I'm sure the wife thanks you as well. I think it's kind of a common concern for people. Will a joint replacement cause problems in the security line at the airport? Nobody wants problems there.
Most definitely. If you look, when you go through security, and the next time you go, particularly if they have the older style machine, which just beeps and it doesn't show a picture, when you walk through the security line, there'll be about five or six elderly people with their hands up being frisked. And the vast majority of those patients have pacemakers or joint replacements. Currently, there's about 6 million joint replacements in the United States. The last study I read, it's probably more by now because the numbers are going up. But there's an awful lot of elderly people who are traveling for vacation, and they're going through those lines, and they're getting stopped. Now, it seems like the newer technology where it actually takes a picture, they can see the implant, and you can get through more. But I would advise you that, you know, the old style of, well, I'm going to run through security and make my plane with 10 minutes to spare is not going to work for somebody with a hip or knee replacement because it may take you a while. You'll get through. There's no cards that they're allowed to look at, not since 9/11. You just have to go there, tell them you have a joint replacement, and they know what to do. But there has to be time for that.
Dr. Starr, I'm going to start to wrap up now, and thank you for all of your expertise. In summary, what are some of the key takeaways that you would like our viewers to leave with today when it comes to joint replacement and minimally invasive surgery and the options that they have?
Well, the studies show that joint replacement surgery is one of the most successful procedures of any procedure for changing a person's life. There's a lot of fear out there that the pain and the disability from these types of procedures is bad, and we're changing that with minimally invasive. One of the ironic stories I always tell is I started doing minimally invasive surgery in younger patients, and some of my older folks, you know, who would be operated on the same day would say to me, why don't I get the opportunity to have that? Because I have a life too. I want to, you know, they don't have to get back to work maybe, but they want to get back to their normal active lives. So the opportunities are there, the implants are getting better, the surgeons are getting better at putting them in, and we have a lot of options and opportunities. We're thinking more about the patients, but we still have non-operative solutions as well. So every doctor you see isn't going to want to rush you right into the operating room. So I think there's a lot of options for patients, and they should at least consider them if it's affecting their quality of life.
I also, before we have to go, thank the viewer, the patient who wrote in and told us that your first name should be Rock because you're such a rock star. I think after tonight, a lot of us can agree with that. So thank you so much, both for that pun to the viewer and Dr. Star for all of your expertise. Before we wrap up, we want to remind everyone that more information is available on Abington's website. We encourage you to check it out. That's abingtonhealth.org/bone. You could also call your physician referral service at 215-481-6334. Our next chat is going to be Thursday, February 20th at 12 p.m. This is a lunchtime chat for all of you folks. That's going to be with Dr. Morris and Dr. Haas from Abington Health. They're going to be educating us on the newest treatment options for congestive heart failure. You can always sign up for reminders and ask your questions ahead of time by registering on www.abingtonhealth.org/healthchats. So if you have a question for Dr. Morris or Dr. Haas, you can go ahead and ask that question now right below here. Don't forget to tell your friends, your family, all the people that you care about that that health chat is coming up. I also want to remind you that you will be able to view this health chat in its entirety right here on the website. So feel free to share it with people, to pass it on, and to make sure that you are sharing all of the great information that Dr. Star gave us today. You can also, and I encourage you, to like Abington Health on Facebook, where you'll be able to get more information and updates. Thank you, Dr. Star, again for sharing so much information and insights with us today. Thank you to the audience and the viewers who gave us great questions for a really robust conversation. And we wish you all a very healthy evening and weekend. Thanks so much. Bye-bye.